Fitzsimmons with Living Beyond Breast Cancer. I'm reporting here from San Antonio Breast Cancer Symposium 2019. I'm here with Dr. Peter Schmid, who just presented the Keystone 522 findings about pembrolizumab in early stage triple negative breast cancer. Dr. Schmid, why don't we start with just what were the basics of the new data you presented here from Keystone 522?
The KEYNOTE-522 trial was, or is, the first randomized phase 3 trial of immune therapy in early triple-negative breast cancer. The trial design is patients with early operable triple-negative breast cancer were randomized between chemotherapy and pembrolizumab and chemotherapy and placebo before surgery for about 6 months, then had surgery, and then continued with pembrolizumab, the immune checkpoint inhibitor, or placebo for a total duration of 1 year. The chemotherapy regimen we chose was a very intensive regimen because it's an aggressive type of cancer. But we also wanted to see whether we can add to the benefits of the most intensive chemotherapy by giving an immune checkpoint inhibitor. So we used 12 weeks of platinum and taxanes followed by 12 weeks of anthracycline-based chemotherapy. The study has two endpoints. One is what we call PathCR, which means the complete disappearance of the cancer at the time of surgery. And that is an endpoint that with chemotherapy has been linked with favorable long-term outcome. So patients who achieve a PathCR have very low recurrence risk, whereas patients who do not achieve a PathCR have a much higher recurrence risk over the years to come. A second endpoint of the trial, something called event-free survival, which means the percentage of patients who get a recurrence over time. And for that, we only have about 15 months follow-up, so the data are early and therefore immature. What we shared here in San Antonio is the final data for PathCR, for pathological complete response, and what we saw is a statistically significant, in my opinion, meaningful increase in the complete disappearance of cancer from 51% to nearly 65%. We saw, and that again I think was very interesting to see, gives me a lot of hope, is in patients who have higher stage disease, stage 3 disease compared to stage 2, or who have lymph node involvement, again, which is linked with a higher risk of recurrence. We saw that what we call the delta, the difference, the added benefit of immune therapy on top of chemotherapy is even higher. It's 20% in patients with lymph node involvement. It's 25% in patients who have stage 3 disease. Now, that is a very encouraging result, and we very much hope that this will also translate into a long-term survival benefit and higher cure rates. After only 15 months of follow-up, which is very short in this type of studies, we already see a 6% difference in the estimated 18 months event-free or recurrence-free survival, which is very encouraging. We also see that what we call the hazard ratio, which gives us the percentage benefit, indicates with a hazard ratio of 0.63, indicates that there's possibly a third fewer recurrences with the addition of immune therapy. Now, these are early data, and they need further confirmation, but the result we see so far is possibly the strongest possible result at such an early time point, which I personally believe will be practice-changing if it isn't already.
Fantastic. We also heard some discussion about the challenges of adding another treatment on top of early stage treatments already, including chemotherapy. So adding immunotherapy to that adds toxicity, adds costs. What about some of the data you presented, especially with the subgroups, add to that discussion?
So if you look at the side effects associated with this treatment, during the phase when patients also have chemotherapy, practically all of the side effects are dominated by chemotherapy. And the differences between patients who receive placebo or immune therapy on top of chemotherapy are very small. As a result, the dose we could give to patients, the number of cycles, the median doses of cycles, the percentage of patients who needed dose reductions or stopped the treatment is practically comparable between patients who receive placebo or immune therapy in addition to chemotherapy. Once we stopped chemotherapy and patients received this treatment alone, immune therapy or placebo after surgery, the rate of side effects was very low, in the range of a few percent. Now, if you focus on the relatively rare, compared to the chemotherapy side effects, but the relatively rare immune-typical or immune-mediated side effects, we see there are a few of those side effects that are clearly more common with immune therapy, and that affects changes, for example, in thyroid function. We see more commonly rash, we see diarrhea, we see pneumonitis, which is an inflammation of the lung, and sometimes an elevation of liver tests. This is obviously something we have known for many years from other immune studies. We know very well how these side effects behave over time. Most of them are treatable, are reversible. We almost have an antidote to those side effects with steroids, and therefore the side effects tend to be very well manageable. Nevertheless, I think in an adjuvant trial, a neoadjuvant trial, it is important to have long-term follow-up, and we will follow up those patients and see whether there are any new safety signals occurring over time.
Great. Thank you for taking the time with us, Dr. Schmidt. They're really congratulations on your study. It's really stunning reports.